And it's kind of shocking to realize that the person I think most people would call the father of economics, Adam Smith, didn't think the pursuit of wealth was a very good idea. Thought it was corrosive, thought it was bad for you, thought ambition was bad for you, thought the pursuit of fame would destroy your character and your happiness, your serenity, your tranquility.
Russ Roberts is the John and Jean Denault Research Fellow at Stanford University's Hoover Institution. Roberts hosts the weekly podcast's Econ Talk, an hour-long conversation with leading authors, economists, and business leaders. He's a frequent contributor to National Public Radio, and he blogs at Cafe Hayek.
We've been going back and forth for a century.
His two rap videos on the ideas of John Maynard Keynes and F.A. Hayek have been viral hits with more than 7 million views on YouTube.
The animal spirit.
His latest book is How Adam Smith Can Change Your Life, an unexpected guide to human nature and happiness. It takes lessons from Adam Smith's lesser-known masterpiece, The Theory of Moral Sentiments, and applies them to modern life. He joins Reason TV and Nick Gillespie for an hour-long conversation about his new work.
Russ, thanks for talking.
Always good to be back.
What brought you to talking about The Theory of Moral Sentiments?
I started reading The Theory of Moral Sentiments really for the first time only a few years ago, and I was totally captivated by many different factors that made the book interesting to me. One is Smith's a great writer. He's fun to read. He's charming. He's the Jane Austen of economics, which is maybe damning with faint praise, but yeah. I think not. He can really write a beautiful sentence. And he had some deep insights into human nature, I thought, and what we're here for and what we were able to achieve and happiness that I thought were worth trying to convey to a general audience.
Moral Sentiments, he revised it over the course of his life, but he wrote that before Wealth of Nations.
I like to think of the book as the book that was ever with him. It was the book he started, it was the book he ended with, and it really bookends The Wealth of Nations. And it's about a very different set of issues from The Wealth of Nations.
Talk about that, because so Moral Sentiments, I mean, it's not about commerce, it's not really about, I mean, in a way it's about public life, but it's not about mercantile life.
Correct. So, it's not about commercial life, right. Although it's about dealing with the people around you, both in your business dealings, your personal dealings. The Wealth of Nations is about The Wealth of Nations. Why are some nations rich? Why are some are poor? Is free trade good? Is free trade bad? Etc. What The Theory of Moral Sentiments is about is why do we feel the way we do about other people, given that we're pretty self-interested, in his day that was pretty accepted. Why do we do nice things, given that we're self-interested? How much can we feel for other people? What motivates us to do good things for other people? And then the related question is, what makes us happy? What brings us satisfaction? And it's kind of shocking to realize that the person I think most people would call the father of economics, Adam Smith, didn't think the pursuit of wealth was a very good idea. Thought it was corrosive, thought it was bad for you, thought ambition was bad for you, thought the pursuit of fame would destroy your character and your happiness, your serenity, your tranquility. So in the two books, it seems to be two different people. Some people suggested there's a paradox here, that here's this guy writes this book about self-interest and how it makes the world go around, and here's this other book, which you could say he wrote when he was young, but actually he wrote it when he was young and when he was old. Here's this other book that says, actually, self-interest isn't the only thing that matters to us. We care a lot about other people.
Well, you kind of sum up the main theme or the main message of The Theory of Moral Sentiments as in the phrase that we should seek or strive to love and be lovely. What does that mean?
So that's my favorite sentence in the book. He says, man naturally desires not only to be loved, but to be lovely. So most of us concede, when we're pushed, that we like to be loved. We like people to pay attention to us. And by loved, he didn't mean romantic love. He included that, but he really meant what we would call respected, honored, admired, paid attention to. So we like, most people like those things. That's a huge source of our contentment, that we have friends, that we have a reputation, etc. And then he takes it a step further. He says, we don't just desire to be loved, we desire to be lovely. That is, we desire to earn the respect and honor and admiration of our friends and fellows by being truly worthy of their honor, respect, and admiration. And that's what he means by lovely. He doesn't mean a nice shirt or outfit or a pretty painting.
And he also means that it has to be legitimate. You talk about it in terms of people like Bernie Madoff or Lance Armstrong. If you seem to be lovely, that means you're a good, well-rounded person, you're successful, you have lots of people around you, but you know that at your core, you're a counterfeiter, you're a fraud. that's not going to cut it.
That's not going to cut it, although you can fool yourself for a long time. You can try to convince yourself you're lovely when you're not. There's a part of the book, and part of my book, is about self-deception, mm-hmm. because the idea that we're not lovely is just really painful. So we really don't like to see ourselves as others see us. We don't want to. We'd rather see ourselves as we think we might be seen. And we have a very, of course, inaccurate, often, portrait of our own well-being, our own self-value.
For Smith, what takes us out of that? I mean, you talk about it also in terms of confirmation bias, that what, you know, we tend to see those parts of ourselves. And it, I mean, it's interesting because you say, like, we might look in the mirror and say, like, oh, my God, look at the schnoz on me or something like that, that we're willing to admit to, you know, certain types of failings. But generally, we want to see ourselves in the best possible light. We have confirmation bias, not just when we see things happening in the world, but in our own lives.
Absolutely.
What takes us out of that?
Well, he has this wonderful idea called the impartial spectator, which is this idea that when we act and when we perceive reality, we imagine our actions and thoughts being viewed by someone who doesn't have a stake in the matter. And I suggest in the book, I don't know if that's really how we really behave. He suggests that's what motivates altruism and compassionate behavior. We want to have a outsider respect us by seeing what we've actually done, someone who isn't blinded by our faults or by our overestimated self-esteem. And I don't know whether that's true or not, but I suggest in the book that that's an interesting way to think about one's own behavior, to step outside yourself and say, in this setting, is my outrage really justified when I'm working myself into a state over some inconvenience or some, quote, injustice? Would an outsider who's not me think that? And I think that's a useful way to step outside yourself and see what's going on.
Is that simply for Smith, you know, who's one of the great men of the Enlightenment, is that simply a secularized version of religion? Of, you know, instead of God is watching us, so I should be good in thought and deed, and now it's an impartial observer?
Well, I think he correctly understood that God wasn't always the most effective restraint on our behavior, even for religious people, right? So he was saying very, I think, radically for his time. He talks a lot about God in the book. It's not like a little quiet thing in the corner that this is like a secret cover for God. He really says this is in many ways, he actually says this is what God put in us because God isn't enough to, or the fear of the world to come or the afterlife or punishment or hell might not be enough. We are judged by our fellows. And that is a huge break on our misbehavior.
Smith seems to put a pretty high premium, and you agree, a fairly high premium on kind of following customs and etiquette and not rocking the boat in a lot of situations. What's going on there?
So when Smith says that you want to be loved and lovely, he says there's different ways to be loved. You can be famous, and everybody pays attention to what you say. You can be rich, and people pay attention to what you say and do. You can be powerful. Similarly, people are going to pay attention to you and really want your love and attention. And there's a wonderful ad for Gatorade that's on YouTube right now with Derek Jeter. And I'm not a big Derek Jeter fan, but
that's
put
because
that to the
if I'm not misremembering, you're from the Boston
area. That's correct. So, I grew up in Boston, and so I understand. This wouldn't be a confirmation bias thing. Yeah. I understand the weakness of his defensive ability, and
that's
of course,
right.
I have to judge
the
him.
Impartial,
honestly.
Impartial observer
exactly.
of you
of
recognizes Derek Jeter is mediocre
correct.
And has just been getting away with
something. Exactly. But as someone who's read The Theory of Moral Sentiments, I'm able to step outside myself and realize that might just be a fact that I grew up in Boston. But anyway, so there's a scene where in this 90-second ad, and it's Frank Sinatra singing My Way in the background, so it has to be good already. It's a great ad, cinematography.
Yeah, another selfless, non-self-promoting, and anti-ambitious person, Frank Sinatra.
Exactly, humble, So in the background is My Way, which is a very emotional song for a person at the end of their life or at the end of their career. And here's Derek Jeter walking through the streets of New York on his way to Yankee Stadium, and he is worshipped. He's not just, oh, hey, Derek. People are in a frenzy over just seeing him. So that's one way to be loved. Derek Jeter is loved in a way that you and I, as much as we are loved, Nick, it's hard to imagine.
Well, you know, speak for yourself, but yes.
So Derek Jeter's loved. So that's one way. Fame, celebrity, money, et cetera, power. But Smith says that's the wrong way to be loved. The right way to be loved is to be virtuous. and to be lovely. And the way to be lovely is to be proper and virtuous. Proper is the minimum standard, what he calls, what we would call propriety. So to act with propriety is the minimum standard, but you really got to get to virtue if you really want to be lovely, truly lovely. And you'll be loved, not in the way that Derek Jeter is loved, but you'll be respected by a smaller circle of friends. And I think he had in mind there somebody like David Hume, who was his best friend and who he respected tremendously, as I suggest in the book, or the way Hume probably respected him. So let's talk about propriety now. So propriety, the right way to be loved, is to take this first step, this minimum standard of propriety. In our day, propriety sort of means stiff and staying within tradition and custom, as you say. I would give a slightly larger range for that idea. I think it's really about meeting the expectations of the people you interact with, not surprising them, not going off the rails and shocking them in a way that makes it hard for them to interact with you in a normal way. So if you have a great success or a great tragedy, you share that with the people around you. And Smith talks about these examples a lot. You share that differently with people you're close to than people who you are not so close to. A great success, for example, you might share with your spouse, but you are not going to share it with a stranger who's maybe a little bit envious of you, who's having a tough time. That would be improper. People do it all the time. they're insensitive. Similarly, people pour out their hearts sometimes to people who can't empathize. And Smith talks a lot about the degrees with which we can empathize with tragedy and success. So propriety, proper behavior, is about meeting those standards.
So it's a fluid change, because you mentioned in the book that we live in a much less formal society, certainly than Smith did, where, you know, in colonial America, you could, if you didn't doff your hat to somebody above your station, you could be put in jail. We're not talking about that kind of, you know, very fixed and formal etiquette. This is more about engaging the people in front
of you. This is about how do you interact with the people around you, which is really the stuff of life. It's what we do all day. We don't think about it much. And I think one of the virtues of Smith's book is it forces you to think about these kind of interactions in a way you normally don't. And it's a beautiful thing.
But isn't there a role for provocation, even in kind of intimate relations, to get people to, you know, think differently and to change in a positive way? And, you know, that could be an entertainment, you know, a show like South Park or somebody like Howard Stern or Lady Gaga. You know, on a certain level, their whole role is to provoke and to transgress certain expectations. And, you know, it can go badly, but it can also be a source of real delight and entertainment.
Sure.
And knowledge.
But, of course, you interviewing me, it would be improper if you didn't do the Nick Gillespie thing. I mean, I expect you to ask offbeat questions about Lady Gaga and to make fun of me being a Red Sox fan. So if you didn't do that, that would be improper.
I was going to actually ask, is the Sharon the book that the book is dedicated to, is that the Sharon who you acknowledge at the end of the book as your long-suffering and incredibly helpful wife?
I can't speak to that.
Okay.
That's
beyond the scope of
exactly.
this.
Exactly.
Yeah. I'm sorry, and I realized we had a discussion. That was supposed to be off the table.
Yeah, there you go.
So propriety, though, is kind of a way station on the way to virtue. And then how is he defining virtue?
So Smith has a lot of different virtues, but the big three for him are prudence, justice, and benevolence. These are words that a little bit old-fashioned. We know what justice is, sort of. Prudence, very old-fashioned term, and benevolence or beneficence, he uses both, are both very hard to understand for a modern ear sometimes. Here's the way I simplify it, and I think it captures what he's talking about. With prudence is you have to take care of yourself. If you want to be lovely, you have to treat yourself well. You have to take care of yourself. Don't become an alcoholic. Don't become a drug addict. Don't be a spendthrift. Spend your money carefully, your time wisely. Don't spend all your time playing video games on the internet or your smartphone.
Yeah, I was reading your book as the iPhone 6 came out this weekend, where 10 million iPhones were sold over this weekend. People waited for a day and a half in line. And Smith actually anticipated
this.
Talk a little bit about that
incredibly
prescient passage, which I guess was first written in 1759.
Yeah, it's kind of stunning. He says basically that we fall in love with little conveniences. He calls them frivolous trinkets of utility, which is really what our gadgets are all about. And in particular, of all things, he picks on the watch, which is ironic given that the iWatch had just come out. And he makes fun of the fact and really judges the person who pays a premium for a watch that's a little more accurate, just because that's kind of amazing and wonderful, but it doesn't make the person any more punctual. They're not more accurate. They just know how inaccurate they are. And so he makes fun of the fact that we love these gadgets. And you think, well, what kind of gadgets were there in 1759? He talks about, and they're not so attractive, an ear picker and a machine for cutting the nails, which must be
like finger and toenail
clippers.
But you go on to point out that actually, on a certain level, there was probably a much better utility to that than taking a dull knife to your finger.
Correct. Just like my iPhone brings me a lot of legitimate pleasure, but it is interesting. I mean, I'm going to confess right here, I have the iPhone 5. And I do have some iPhone 6 envy, I feel. Yeah. Even though I can make a perfectly good phone call with the iPhone 5, I mean, what really am I getting better? But we have a craving that he understood back in 1759 for the latest thing, for the coolest thing, for the most. He liked, and I think this is part of what we like about gadgets, he understood that people in 1759 liked the way they did their job, the gadget. Not what the job actually was, but just that it was well constructed. We have almost an aesthetic sense for that, which I think is part of what Steve Jobs was about, obviously, and it's part of what we care about with these gadgets.
But then you can go overboard if you're mortgaging everything or you're not saving for retirement or for that operation you need because you need
Correct.
The next.
So that would be imprudent.
Right.
So prudence is a virtue. Justice is a virtue. Justice, he uses the word many different ways, but one of the ways he uses, I think, that's most important here is don't hurt people. That's pretty straightforward. We understand that. Don't be a bad person. The next one, though, is the challenge, because that's beneficence. That's being a good person. That means not just I'm not going to hurt you, but I'm actually going to help you. And that's harder to do. It's not obvious. I use the example, love your neighbor as yourself. Well, that's a good idea. How do I do that? It's hard to do. Emotionally, it's very hard to do. But how do I implement that? So he makes a contrast between the laws of justice, which are sort of black and white. Don't steal, don't bang anybody over the head, don't hurt them, and the laws of beneficence, which are, he calls, loose, vague, and indeterminate. He makes a contrast, an analogy between grammar, which we have a set of rules, and composition. The rules of composition are loose, vague, and indeterminate. How do you be a good writer is more of a craft than being accurate and speaking English well. So similarly, if you want to be virtuous, being just, that's not so hard, being beneficent, being helpful to people around you, that's a lot trickier.
Is it part of beneficence? And, and this also, one of the things that is different in our world, I think, than Smith's, is that we recognize there are many different ways out there. I mean, he helped create the idea of toleration, not just in a religious sense, but in a kind of lifestyle
sense.
And wouldn't it be wrong for us to simply say, you're speaking broken grammar, bad English, or you have a weird accent, or you use words peculiarly, to just be like, so I'm not going to listen to you? I mean, and there seems to be a tension in Smith between, having one set of rules that are kind of universal values, but then also realizing that those really have very clear limits in how you get about in the world.
Well, I see Smith, as you say, as really an extraordinarily tolerant person. He's very unjudgmental. He was against slavery, unlike some of the people of his era and later who felt slavery was necessary because there are certain people who can't rule themselves, who won't do well with being unconstrained. And Smith really was a modern in that sense, that he understood that was really a horrible idea, that people have the right to their own choices, their own lives.
And even not just necessary slavery, he also
Irish
wanted
people.
To empower.
No, I'm serious. He was...
I'm saying that it's not simply slavery, but, kind of masterless men who were starting to crowd into cities. I don't know that he was particularly advanced on the woman issue, but he was a modern specifically, and he thought that we all had a basic humanity and we should be allowed to make as many choices as possible in our lives.
Yeah,
right. I mean, he's
absolutely
a true liberal.
So I don't think he lived in a time and a culture where propriety and other rules were much more pervasive. Mm-hmm. And I think what was acceptable behavior was much more narrow in his day than in ours, and he lived in that time. I don't think, he wasn't a rebel, yeah. But I think, as you suggest, he, in many ways, he laid the groundwork for people to be free in different ways.
Well, to follow up, definitely not a rebel. Although, I mean, and it's interesting because his thoughts were actually totally revolutionary, but he was not a rebel in any kind of social
way. Social rebel.
And I'm quoting from the Theory of Moral Sentiments. He goes on to write, "The traitor who conspires against the life of his monarch is thought a greater monster than any other murderer. All the innocent blood that was shed in the civil wars provoked less indignation than the death of Charles I." Of course, he's writing about 100 years. Okay, and then you update that by saying, you know, also that, you know, people like to follow rulers because they want to. And you say, think of Chavez or Castro or even the way many Russian people today romanticize Stalin. People have an admiration for these monsters that is difficult to explain. Logic may decree that a king deserves to be overthrown, but our hearts find it difficult. I want to question that. I mean, is Smith being naive here? He's from a very particular time and place and a class position where, you know, there were lots of people who were happy that Charles I was beheaded, and they were right to. He was a despot. I mean, the problem is that Cromwell and the Commonwealth that came after, you know, became just as repressive.
That's not Smith's point.
Oh yeah, no. But and also in talking about people or talking about rulers and the apparent willingness to follow them, is this also missing the fact that rulers, particularly despotic rulers, rule with an iron hand? I mean, Charles I, later Cromwell, Castro, Chavez. It's not like people are happy to follow them. Everybody knows that if you don't follow them, you're going to be killed, you're going to be punished, you're going to be tortured. And I guess I raise this on a certain level. Is there a naivete embedded in Adam Smith's thought here?
Yeah, it might not be so much a naivete as an unawareness of how monstrous a tyrant could actually be. Mm-hmm. You could argue he couldn't have imagined a Stalin, so maybe it's unfair of me to invoke Stalin there or Hitler. But I think, here's what I think he had right. Let's put aside the details of his naivete for a moment. What I think he had right is that we do care a lot about the rich, famous, and powerful. Many, many people adore them, and that's puzzling. What's special about these people that make them worthy of our attention? And that's a hard thing to understand, I think. It's a hard thing to write down. It's a hard thing to understand why their death, forget whether they were a tyrant or not, why their death is so emotionally difficult for so many people.
And you talk about this in terms of people like Princess Di, Elvis, John Lennon, et cetera.
Yeah, these are people that, they're successful people.
Right.
And Smith tries to say that the reason we find their deaths so tragic, including the rulers and the tyrants, is that they've scripted this glorious epic, and it ends unhappily, it ends abruptly. We want it to go on forever. In fact, I think to some extent it's an escape for us that those lives are fabulous. They don't think a lot about what their lives are really like, and I write in the book about how many of these people are not so happy actually day to day. And Smith says so. He says that this is a very unrewarding way to be loved, is to attract this adulation and adoration from the masses. But I think it's striking, and I didn't write a lot about this in the book because I didn't want to step on too many toes and get into too much politics, but there are a lot of people who worship the president, right, in the United States, left and right, Republican and Democrat. They put pictures of the president in their house sometimes, right? That's strange to me.
Yeah.
They're just politicians. Now, I've met a few. You've probably met a few in your time. They put their pants on one leg at a time, mostly. A lot of them are men. They're sort of everyday human beings. They're not gods.
Right.
And yet we revere them in ways that are so outsized relative to their accomplishments, their personality, their essence. So
what is it then? I mean, either that Smith identifies. I mean, it's not simply a kind of vicarious thrill. I mean, some of it is entertainment. I think people follow, you know, Keeping Up with the Kardashians or something. It's not because they're like, oh, I really care.
Some of it's vicarious. I'm living that. But I think what Smith says, whether he's right or not, I don't know. But what Smith says is we imagine what their lives must be like without the full set of details.
Yeah,
we have this very idealized romantic view of what day-to-day life is as Derek Jeter or as Lady Gaga or as President Obama. And we think of it with such romance. We've stripped away all the the pain and the negative and the work that it took to get there and the future that may not be as rewarding, et cetera, and the dark days. And we say, wow, that's the vicarious part. I think we say, that's a wow, what a beautiful life, what an achievement. And the fact that they are flawed, and you can take any American president. You don't have to be a Democrat or Republican. You can take any American president. They're all terribly flawed. They're just human beings. Why do we give them that love that they earn, that they seem to get? I don't think they earn it, but they get it.
Let's stick a little bit more on Smith as a life god, life guide, rather, life god. You know, among the other things that are interesting about Adam Smith, he never married. He
Correct.
Is kind of...
lived with his mom most of his life.
I was going to say he's kind of like Norman Bates or Rupert yeah. Pupkin from yeah. The King of Comedy.
What's the matter with you? Mom!
I don't know if he had like his own room in the basement. Or,
I don't think so. But
and he was described by people like James Boswell, a contemporary, the biographer of Samuel Johnson, as a kind of prototype of the absent-minded professor. He apparently told Boswell that he didn't want to talk about his books in public because he thought it might hurt his sales. So that he was not a particularly good conversationalist. He would ask about things he didn't know. How do we factor that into any yeah. kind of evaluation of how far we should take him?
Well, I'm not going to name names, but we can all think of people we know in our daily lives as well as in the public space who are charming by the fact that they're a little bit off, or at least off the beaten track. Smith was, I think, quite charming. I think he was a pretty good conversationalist, that Boswell story. Even with that, he went to the continent. He was a superstar. People wanted to be around him. They were partly impressed with his book, but they also, I think, found him good company.
Yeah, and you have a particularly great moment where he's at a dinner where yeah. it's kind of like the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen sitting yeah. around a table, standing up when he arrived to dinner late.
Right.
Repeat that.
So William, it was a dinner with William Pitt. It was Wilberforce, one of the great abolitionists of his day. There are all these great British luminaries, and they're standing when he gets there late for whatever reason, and they all rise, and Smith, whether he's embarrassed or not or thinks he should be, says, "Oh no, please, please sit down." And Pitt says, "We are all your students." And they were rising for a professor, which doesn't happen very often, by the way, in the modern times. But in olden times, people would respect the learned because they were rare.
Right.
And that was, I would think, in many ways, the ultimate compliment that these extraordinary people were respectful of him. He was loved in that way. By the way, there's a debate whether that story actually happened. It might be apocryphal, but it's a nice story.
You know, one of the, kind of fuse that with the overlove or the too much reverence for politicians, you have a great chapter in the book about making the world a better place. And you have a line in there which, I think I hear in my own head 10 times a day about how politics isn't the place where life happens or something along those lines. Talk a little bit about the Smithian vision that you tease out of Moral Sentiments of how to make the world a better place.
Well, I do tease it out because Smith doesn't have a chapter in the Theory of Moral Sentiments called How to Make the World a Better Place. But what he talks about, which is to me utterly fascinating, is how civilization, literally civilization, emerges without top-down control. It's the ultimate example of what Hayek called spontaneous order, what I like to call emergent order, things that occur from the bottom up through the decentralized actions of millions of people. And what Smith said is that the author of nature, God, put inside us a worry about what other people think of us that constrains us from doing what we really want to do, which is often to be selfish. And that's a remarkable thing. And I watch and I see what other people do. I look at their behavior and I see what's considered gracious. I see what's considered lovely. So I express gratitude because people say thank you all the time. So I say, oh, that's people like that. So I learn to say thank you. And of course, your parents or my parents help us to do that. But all the little pieces of civilized life, which are, we don't even notice them. Gratitude, empathy, sympathy, kindness, charity, kind feelings, helping someone when they're struggling, all these things, where'd they come from? Who said that's a good idea? And we have lots of cultural forces, of course, that make those things happen. But what Smith's pointing out is that those things happen at a micro level. They come from all the myriad of encounters we have day to day with all the people around us. And if we're a selfish, unpleasant person, we don't have so many friends and life's not so pleasant. But if we're a good person and we do the right thing, people honor us and we're friendly to us and are nice to us. And so Smith, what he's talking about really is that there are these feedback loops built into the world that encourage good behavior and punish bad behavior. They're very imperfect, of course, so I don't want to suggest this is, you know, solves all problems. But Smith understood that an enormous sphere of everyday life is outside of the legal system. It's outside of politics. It's just part of how we interact with each other. And that isn't designed by anyone. It emerges. And that means that we, as individuals, have a chance to enhance that or take a step back from it. When we see people doing good things, we should be nice to them and honor them and thank them and tell them. And we see people doing bad things, we should do the reverse. And that's one way to make the world a better place that has a ripple effect, small, but actually maybe real, to enforce and enhance this incredible web of interactions that we have that create civilization.
And that obviously has an analog in kind of market forces. When, you know, your decision, and I think you talk about, you know, your decision to buy apples or not.
Correct.
In the end, is not going to, it doesn't have that much meaning in and of itself, but as it gets multiplied throughout an economy, things change.
Any one person's demand for apples don't determine the price of apples, but all of us together, if we all said, yeah, we're not eating apples anymore, that would be the end of the apple market.
So talk a little bit about, is there a continuity, though, between, say, you know, being nice and beneficent and just and moral at the local, you know, at the intimate level, at the interpersonal level, you know, and then how do you eradicate slavery? You know, you talked about William Wilberforce, the great abolitionist, being at, you know, at a dinner with Adam Smith, and they agreed on this. Is there a continuity between these types of behaviors? Because slavery didn't end, you know, simply because people started being nice to each
Correct.
Other.
Correct. And it's one thing to say, well, I'm going to follow the virtue of justice. I'm not going to enslave anybody. That's good. That's a start. But that's not as good as ending slavery. Now, we could debate on whether slavery is the result of, I think, to a large degree in the United States, slavery was a result of a misuse of the property system and the power of the state, that it would have been much harder to sustain slavery without government power. But it's certainly the case that there are many, many things that cannot be done voluntarily through individual and voluntary collective action. Let me say that a different way. I think there's a lot we can accomplish through voluntary collective action to help fight poverty, make better schools, et cetera, through our non-governmental, non-top-down actions. But there's some things that are hard to do without the power of the state. There's no doubt about it. And I think Smith conceded that. Smith was not an anarcho-capitalist. He wasn't a libertarian. He had what my friend Dan Klein at George Mason calls a presumption of liberty. He said, that's where you start. You want to go away from liberty, you got to make the case for me. I love that way of thinking about politics. I think that's a very healthy way. I'm a little more of an ideologue than Smith that way, but I think that's the way Smith saw it.
You also talk about in the book how work or commercial life needs a romantic vision on some level, because this is, you know, part of the problem is that a lot of the things Smith was talking about, particularly, you know, whether in his own, you know, in either of his works, but then in our day, it's hard to kind of create a vision of heroism or of even like positive thinking about business or commercial life. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, we live in a remarkable time where a strikingly large group, but not anything close to maybe a majority, but a strikingly large group actually love their work. If you think about human history, this is really rare.
And I mean, we're talking like 50 years ago.
Exactly. 50 years ago, 90-something percent of people hated their work. It was just something you did to bring money into the house, put food on the table. We live in a time now where a lot of people get a lot of meaning, a lot of fulfillment from their work, and I think that's basically a good thing. And I think it would be an even better thing if the people who make that possible, who do create the products and the companies and services that we enjoy, were respected a little bit more. A few are. Mm-hmm. We mentioned Steve Jobs earlier. Steve Jobs clearly is adored by a small group of crazy people. I'm in that group. Yeah.
And you mentioned that, you know, at least for long sections of his life, he was not particularly admirable.
Doesn't appear to be lovely. Yeah. Right. He's loved, but doesn't he? I think would confess as much. Yeah. And he chose a biographer who did not whitewash his character issues. As a father, as a husband, or as an employer, as a boss.
As an intermittent user of deodorant.
And shoes. Yeah. There are a lot of things that were different. Definitely not a proper guy, and God bless him. Good for the world.
But he did help to mainstream the idea that work is not something, it's not drudgery, it can be an expression of who you are and what you believe, what you
think. I'm not sure that's... should be our goal is to create a culture like that, but I don't think it serves us well to have the opposite, which is that commercial life is somehow tawdry, that it's somehow essentially exploitive, that most people are being abused in the workplace. I think that's just a terrible, it's not true for starters, and I think having that as your sort of other religion is not so healthy.
Well, talk, because this is the place where theory of moral sentiments kind of merges or you know comes into contact with Wealth of Nations. Is there a, and you point out that you don't want, and this is, it strikes me as kind of in conversation, if not disagreement, with one of your great personal mentors, Gary Becker, the Nobel Prize winner, saying, you know, you don't want a lot of economic, you don't want homo economicus to be running your family life.
Correct.
But by the same token, you also talk about how one of the great values of a global marketplace is that you really don't have to care about where stuff's coming from. You don't have to know who's growing the peas that are finally ending up on your plate.
And I would suggest that's probably a very good thing.
Yeah, for everybody.
For everybody, mainly because we're all flawed. And if your goal in life is to only interact with flawless people, you're going to be very lonely. If your goal in life is only to interact with people who you can verify and vouch for as being lovely people, you're going to be very poor because that's a very small group of people. The way I see the interaction between the Wealth of Nations and the Theory of Moral Sentiments is the Theory of Moral Sentiments is about my day-to-day life with people I see face-to-face. Even by 1776, when Smith was publishing the Wealth of Nations, a lot of your commercial interactions is with strangers, and that is a wonderful thing. And the reason that's a wonderful thing, it's great when you know the people who grew your apples and you can chat with them over the fence and all that. There's a certain nice poetry to that.
Assuming they have good apples.
Yeah, that'd be a minimum standard. That's correct. There's a certain poetry to that, but if that's what you do, you're going to be very poor, because what Smith understood really better than anyone is how specialization and the division of labor drives prosperity. And if you're only going to interact with a few people, you can't have a lot of specialization. So Smith understood that prosperity really was coming out of this willingness to trade with people you didn't know so well, and to offer them not kindness, but money, or something for them, which is how Smith words it. You know, when you make a deal with someone, instead of telling them why it's good for you, explain what's good for them when on the other side of the deal.
And this is undergirding the great line about how it's not from the beneficence of the baker or the butcher or whatever that you, they prepare your dinner for.
They don't do it because they love you. They do it because there's something in it for them. And that's not so bad, because if it were otherwise, you'd be very hungry. So we don't want to run our family like a business, but we don't want to run our economic system like a family. And that comes back to Hayek in Fatal Conceit, where he says, if you try to make your family like the outside world where you trade, you're going to have a very miserable family life. But he said, if you try to extend the relationships of the family into the outside world, which is what socialism romanticizes, he says it's going to lead to tyranny. I think he's onto something.
Now, I mean, let's talk about that and segue into a question, a larger question that runs through not just this book, but a lot of your work about the knowledge problem, or what Hayek considered a knowledge problem we talked about. Is it possible, though, or how do you erect kind of barriers to kind of economic thinking from, or economic pressures from the outside kind of crushing the family, either, you know, in a Marxist sense as a unit of production, or as a haven from a heartless world in a way that Victorians would talk about it? I mean, is it really possible to separate these things out?
Well, what Hayek said is that you have to act as if you were of two minds. Mm-hmm. You have to have one mindset when you're out in the commercial world and one mindset when you're in with your family and your intimates and your friends. And that's hard to do. And I think a lot of what's troubling and difficult about modern life is that those differences are broader than ever, right? We're trading much more globally, and the family is a little more challenged than it's been in the past. It's hard to keep that going.
Well, and it's, I mean, because, you know, one of the problems that I know that scholars of German history talk about, you know, this is, you saw this in a really grotesque, barbaric light where, you know, the commandants of death camps would come home and play with their kids and their dogs
sure.
and listen to Beethoven. And it's,
Hitler was a big dog lover.
Yeah, it's just, you know, it's hard to, you know, if you have two separate spheres, anything goes in one that doesn't go in the other, or can, in terms of if you're trading with some merchant that you've never heard of or you don't even know who it is, you're more likely to screw them over than you are if it's somebody in your family.
Correct. And that's why repeated dealing is one way that in the most global system, there's still repeated dealing. There's still, people are aware of the threat of opportunism, and so they look for ways to try to restrain it. For me, the interesting issues are things like, you know, we don't auction off food to our kids when there's one chicken leg left and both kids want the leg or the last piece of cake.
It would be more efficient, wouldn't it?
It would be more efficient, but efficiency is not a good thing to strive for.
Right.
And I think that's a terrible misuse of economics that people, I think, misunderstand what the price system is really supposed to do. And that's not what it's supposed to do there.
Yeah, well, let's talk about economics broadly and the knowledge problem. You know, you have consistently throughout a lot of your work have brought to bear, you know, the fact if we take seriously the idea that Hayek, you know, Smith gets at, Hayek really kind of articulated as a knowledge problem, that we really don't know as much as we know, and we certainly don't have independent verification in the realm of economic science any more than we do, you know, we allow ourselves to be duped by confirmation bias of how lovely we are. You have a great quote from Nassim Taleb using an old Venetian proverb that said, the sea gets deeper as you go further into it. Where do you think, what is the root of a kind of economist, the hubris that economists, whether they're right-wing or left-wing, whether they're market-based or they're kind of more interventionist, where is the hubris coming from that they seem to, you know, many of them feel that economics is now a full-fledged science?
Sure.
And, you know, yeah, they've got, you know, good levers. They
yeah.
can spin dials and make everything all right.
Well, man naturally desires not only to be loved, but to be lovely. And that loved part's very powerful. And if you want to be loved as an economist, if you want people to pay attention to you, if you want to be invited to the circles of power, you have to be confident. Otherwise, you don't get invited. So there's a terrible, I think, tendency in our field to pretend that we know the answers, because that's how you get on not just the talk shows, but it's how you get invited to the places where you can have control over other people. It's a very tempting human characteristic.
Hayek in the Counter-Revolution of Science talked a lot about how there was a certain kind of scientistic dimension to the Enlightenment, which yeah. he identified, and I think there's reasons to question this, but as a particularly continental sensibility. And that in contemporary times, and people like Bruce Caldwell, a intellectual biographer of Hayek, has said that, you know, kind of the substitution of formulas and of kind of the appropriation of techniques from the physical sciences
yeah.
to social sciences, particularly economics, gives this false sense of certitude.
Correct.
You would agree with that?
Absolutely.
And then what are the ways to kind of push back on that? Because economics now occupies the place of pride in the social sciences, or arguably in the academy. It seems to be, you know, economists are rock stars now. They are, you know, they're being called into, you know, political situations to say, you know, fix this. Janet Yellen, a highly respected economist, goes into, you know, running the Federal Reserve. We were waiting, Greenspan was the Oracle of Delphi. People, you know, whenever he picked his nose, people, you know, markets would plunge. How do we get out of this mindset that economists really are running the show?
Well, I think a number of people know the emperor doesn't have so much clothing on, so I think it's not quite as, all of that you say is true. Economists are highly respected, that's true. We do have a lot of power, that's true. But I think a lot of people are kind of skeptical of us, and rightfully so. I think it's important for economists within the profession to admit that sometimes the emperor doesn't have any clothes. We don't know what's going to happen when this tax cut passes, or this spending program passes, or this law is changed in this particular way. And every time that we fail to predict those accurately, I think smart people start to think, hey, maybe this isn't science. I like to see us be more like historians, which is what I think is our level of credibility. Nobody pretends to measure the impact of, say, one of the treaties before World War I on causing the war. We say, well, the treaties had something to do with it. These alliances sprung into motion, but they were there for a while and they didn't cause a war. So why then? Well, there were these forces of nationalism, the Serbian thing. We got the Russian desire for expansion into the to a port. All these things work together. Well, which one was 27%? How much was this factor? Well, I don't know. It's history. People disagree about what happened. They don't pretend they know what happened. And I think we should have that same level of honesty. And I invite my fellow economists to join me. And every once in a while, one of them does. Yeah. And you know, and they concede that this is true. I recently interviewed Lars Hansen, Nobel laureate in economics, and he says, yeah, models about systemic risk are very flawed. And I said, well, maybe that's inherent in the process. His view is we just need to do a little bit better. We just need a better one. And I'm hoping someday people will join the view, will come to the view, which is the Hayekian view, which is, yeah, you don't need more data points. The problem is inherently unsolvable. As he said in his 1974 Nobel laureate address, the pretense of knowledge. You have the pretense of knowledge. You don't have the real thing. You have scientism, not real science.
So how does that, you know, as I was researching, talking to you, I noticed on your Wikipedia page, which obviously is accurate because it's crowdsourced, so it's like a market price.
It's on the internet.
It can't be wrong. But it associated you with the Austrian School of Economics. And obviously Hayek is, you know, one of the premier Austrians. But so is Ludwig von Mises, and Ludwig von Mises had a notion of extreme a priorism, where he agreed, you know, yeah, we really can't ever get good data, but we also can know things about the outside world, and we know that certain things are axiomatically true, because they must be true. Is that as much of a problem as the kind of mathematization of economics?
Well,
and how do you, I guess a larger question also is, you knowing that your knowledge is limited, or your ability to predict the future or explain the past is limited, you still have predilections and proclivities that you know in your heart of hearts are more likely to be true than not. You know, how do we get out of the prisons of our own making, whether it's too much math or it's too much a priorism? Because at the end of the day, like you have a sense that your knowledge is limited, your ability to predict the future is probably as weak as your ability to really fully explain the past, but you still have policies that you would propose. How do we deal with these types of issues?
Well, let me go back a little bit and talk a little bit about the Austrian school. I think Don Boudreau, my friend and former colleague at George Mason, used to place me somewhere over the Atlantic Ocean, sort of halfway between Chicago and Austria. I moved a lot. I think I'm on land now, but I'm moving east. I'm heading toward the continent and away from the United States. So I have an Austrian flavor to my work that's comes from my respect for Hayek mostly. I do think there's a danger of being overconfident about your a priori knowledge of how the world works. And I don't want to go so far as to say that numbers or data or evidence is irrelevant. We just can rely on intuition, say, or principles. I think knowledge about data and how the world works is useful. I just think we often overextend it into areas it doesn't successfully work at, and we use statistical techniques that are not as reliable as they appear. So I think that's the case. But the real question you ask, I think, is the hard question, which is, it's sort of embodied in this phrase I'm starting to see more often, strong opinions weakly held. So I have strong opinions, but I concede that, you know, I don't really have 100% proof that they're right. I might have some faith, I have some intuition, I have some evidence, and I ignore the evidence that's not going with my side. So I should be open about that. But the question is, where does that leave you? How do you advance liberty, say, or the ideas that you care about? And I like to think that there's certain basic principles that are true, that there are implications we could debate about, but they're true. And those are things about human nature. Those are things about that we are mainly self-interested.
How do we prove that we understand human nature?
I don't think we can prove it. I do think we have a certain shared reality that we would mostly concede, that we are more self-interested than altruistic, for example, that power corrupts, that knowledge is scarce. It's these principles that I will hold to. Those are strong opinions, strongly held, and I think most people share them. Where we disagree, somebody say, an interventionist economist would disagree with me is, well, how important is that? How important are incentives? How important, say, if you're arguing about the minimum wage? And I'm happy to have an argument about the minimum wage, about the role of incentives, right? But I'm really not so happy to have it over the latest econometric study, which I know was cooked in a kitchen I really don't want to go back and look in, because there were 4,000 statistical runs of the data before they found the one that they decided after the fact was probably the right one.
So can I ask, just to be specific, with something like the minimum wage, I assume that you would say that there's a good chance, depending on how big, if the minimum wage goes up modestly, say 10%, a fair number of people will get a raise of 10%, and then there will be some non-trivial number of people who will lose their jobs.
Correct.
And then how do we use that to inform policy decisions? So should we raise the minimum wage or not?
So let's say you and I disagree on this. I suspect we don't, but let's say we disagree. I know a lot of people who disagree with me on this. Many of them are economists. And two generations ago, there was almost no disagreement among economists over this, but now there's some disagreement. It's pretty large, actually, the people who think it's probably a good idea to raise the minimum wage. So to me, the way you debate that or discuss it is you talk about data, evidence, but not the kind that usually is talked about. The kind that's usually talked about is this study that surveyed 400 restaurants and they showed that, this, that, and the other, but did you control for this, 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 and this? No, we couldn't, but that's the best we could do. Yeah. Well, I don't find that so convincing, and most people don't. I'm more eager to talk about, again, fundamental principles, which is, do you concede that businesses move jobs overseas because they get a lower rate there? And yet you don't think they respond to a higher cost of labor domestically to substitute machinery? Now you can argue, a legitimate argument coming back is, well, this particular industry, the machinery can't substitute very well for people. Okay, I'm open to that, let's talk about that. But I'm not gonna prove my point. And I think we ought to be honest. You and I should be honest, and people on the other side should be honest. My dislike for the minimum wage is partly motivated by the fact that I care about poor people, and I don't like to see the people with the least skills bear the brunt of this so-called great social policy.
Which pretty much everybody will agree with. It's a question of how
magnitude.
Magnitude. So, you know.
But back in my mind, when I'm honest with myself, part of the reason I don't like the minimum wage is I don't like the idea that government should be involved in deciding what people earn. And I think on the other side, this may be some idea that that's kind of a feature, not a bug. And so the real debate that's going on in the background is, how much should government be able to decide what's going on in our lives? Because I'm an expert, I can do it better, versus my view, which says, I think we should probably stand back and let people make their own decisions. That's the real debate.
Yeah, where do those ideas come from in you? Have you been able to trace back a place, where did those ideas, is that just temperament? Were you born that way? Did you have a particularly strong, inner libertarian moment of awakening? You have a great, I was going to call it a digression. It's not quite that. You have an extended critique of the drug war in this book. In which, to talk about how incentives get screwed up and how trying to force people to do things rarely works the way that it's intended.
Smith beautifully said that it's, he talks about the man of system who thinks he can move the pieces on the chessboard of life the way he wants them to go, when in fact they have their own independent motion. And that, I think, is a very good lesson to think of when we think about the drug war and many other things.
But so why is liberty so important to you? Or why is it so important that the government not do this, that, or the other thing?
Well, that's a tough question. One thing I have learned is I don't have those views because of what I like to think would be the answer, which is, well, I looked out into the world and I saw the evidence and I weighed it and then I came to this view that liberty is good. I don't think that's really why I think liberty is good. It has to do partly where I chose to go to school, the jobs I took, Some of us like being like other people. Some of us like pushing back against other people. I know a lot of people in the liberty movement who are not so attractive human beings, but because they
are not the best spokespeople for our cause
because they like being antagonistic.
Right.
And there's people on the left like that also. We all know that.
Well, to bring it back to Smith, he was one of the people at a particular stage in Western development or in world development who was of a privileged class. He was a professor. He was, you know, he was a man. He was a world-renowned author after a certain point. And one of the most radical things he said, and again, he wasn't rebellious, but he said, you know, everybody should have more room to make choices in their life. You know, that's the classical liberal project, really, was to say that even the lowest among us,
the porter,
yeah, you know, could, you know, might be able to buy whatever they want or to dress how they want or to vote how they or have
think
a
about
vote.
What
yeah.
they want.
You know, are we still moving forward on that project, or do you feel like things are starting to either soften or plateau or go backwards?
The most pessimistic thing is that in what you could argue is the world's freest country, which is the United States, government just seems to inexorably get larger and larger. And this strange view that somehow the 80s, the Thatcher-Reagan revolution, the Milton Friedman revolution, the Hayekian revolution, was this dark moment in the liberal world, leftist worldview. Where was I missed that.
I don't disagree with you, but I know I was in college and the drinking age went from 18 to 21.
Yeah.
So there was that.
That's a dark age.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
But no, the claim is that right. we had all this liberty, this deregulation, but in fact, the truth is it's very small. In fact, when I interviewed Milton Friedman in 2006, shortly before he died, he was very sad and it was very poignant because I was talking about how many of his ideas had now become mainstream.
Right.
Many of them had come to pass. Volunteer army, the idea that maybe we could privatize social security, the idea of flexible exchange rates, all these things.
School choice.
Yeah. All these things we're making progress on. He kept saying the glass is half empty. You know, there's so little we've achieved. So on the one hand, it's pessimistic. We've achieved very little. Government gets bigger. On the other hand, life's pretty good. I wish more people had access to the good life in the United States. I wish more people had access to decent schooling. I think that's the biggest barrier. Somehow, despite the size of government, we kind of go, it's like a giant rock, a boulder, it gets bigger and bigger. There is a threat, maybe one day it'll dam the river, but most of the time, we just run over
it. Well, you talk about it in the book, and I think you attribute this to Smith as well, but then, I mean, you tease it out into a kind of modern parlance that the best thing we can do for kind of freedom or for progress or, you know, moving towards a better world is really to generate more economic growth. What are the large goals of that? Again, you cannot say exactly what policies will do that, but what are the general things that we're not listening to?
I'm not sure I came out saying we need to generate more growth. I think what we need to generate is more opportunity. And that's related to growth. I think it's clear that there is a large segment of the population that's not part of the incredible economy that's out here. It's an incredible economy with terrible flaws right now. We're not a great time in the aftermath of the Great Recession. But despite that, if you have a college education and you study something somewhat valuable, you have a pretty good life in America, a really extraordinary life. And the number of people enjoying that is growing. I like to see it even wider. I don't mean more people need to go to college, but more people need the opportunity. I'd like there to be a chance for more people to be able to express themselves and to flourish. And I think that
schooling system,
as an obvious thing, I want to get the government out of the school system because I think it's done a terrible job. And anybody who disagrees with that, if you ask them, should we spend more money on schooling, they'd all say yes. And I want to say, where is the evidence that that's a good idea? We have a lot of evidence it's a bad idea. So please join me in trying something different. It doesn't have to be what I'd want, which is no government schools. That would get the government totally out of it and rely on private charity to help poor people. And you say, oh, but so many people wouldn't give. Yeah, but right now, your system on the other side has poor people suffering horribly and not getting a decent education. Your system's not working. Well, we just got to do it better. That's a nice idea. You got to tell me how you're going to make it happen rather than just desire it. It's not enough. But on the other side, on the optimism side, because you, as you said, when you were in when they raised the drinking age on you, I want to ask what year that was. But I know that you're old enough you remember when our views were like kooky, crazy ideas, and there was nobody joining us, and nobody understood it, and nobody read about it. It's ironic that we live in this time where people complain about how people don't read anymore, and they're all stuck in front of screens. I hope they're stuck in front of your screens watching Reason TV, because it's extraordinary how many people are interested in liberty and liberty ideas of Hayek and Friedman and other people. It's a glorious time in that way, and I'm always optimistic. I always think we can make some progress.
Final question, is there going to be another Keynes Hayek video?
I hope so. John Popola, my co-creator, and I, we talk about it. Some would say two is more than enough, but I'd love to have a third one. I think you can't have too many, and I'm serious, that you can't have too many approaches to economic education and to making the case for liberty that go beyond just text and books and other things.
There's a boom and bust cycle and good reason to fear it. Play low interest rates. No, it's the animal spirits.
Well, we will leave it there. Russ Roberts, I want to thank you for talking to Reason TV. Russ Roberts is at the Hoover Institution, and his most recent book is How Adam Smith Can Change Your Life, An Unexpected Guide to Human Nature and Happiness. Thank you so much, Russ.
My pleasure, Nick.
Yo. We've been going back and forth for a century. I want to steer markets. I want them set free.